Oh, just pray, Lord, that you'd give us a fire, Lord. We want more of you, God. I pray that you ignite something within us this morning, that we just can't help but just run from this place with your Holy Spirit and take it to other people, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that each person here senses your presence this morning, Lord, and that as they go from here, Lord, they feel you. God, you are good and you are moving. We just want to give the rest of this morning to you, Lord. Speak to us in whatever way. In your holy and precious name we pray.
Ushers to come at this time. God, we thank you this morning that you provide for us. It's one of the amazing gifts. And as we give to you, God, it's out of our provision. It's out of love. Take these gifts that we give now, God. Use them to love the world. In Christ's name, amen. So he's the son of a dairy farmer in North Carolina. And Friday, his life was celebrated in memorial service. God embraced him with 99 years on this planet. Born in 1918, one William Franklin Graham Jr. passed away, and his wife was remembered last Friday. I hope you had a chance to see it. If you didn't, YouTube is our best friend in this kind of thing. I would encourage you to go to and watch his memorial service. I'm a zealot. I'm a nut. I'm a preacher. So I not only watched it live, but I have on my car radio, Kathy loved this yesterday when she got into the car, but I have the Billy Graham station on the radio, XM, and he's preaching constantly. But it's awesome. It's awesome to just hear his voice again. I mean, it takes me back to my childhood, takes me back into days of television sets and sitting there with my parents watching the Billy Graham Crusade and listening to Just As I Am and those things that were done in those crusades and watching hundreds and thousands of people respond to the gospel. So I want to use his life this morning, some of the parts of his life. I hope it will inspire you to understand that God grabbed a hold of the heart of a 15-year-old. A what? A 15-year-old son of a dairy farmer in North Carolina, who in his own words was out playing baseball one day. He came back in from playing baseball, and his mom said, "Hey, do you want to go to church with me tonight?" Mordecai Hamlin, a famous evangelist, was at their church and was bringing the messages, and his mom wanted Billy to hear them. So Billy went with his parents, who were devout followers of God. I know this wasn't the only time he went to church, but it was a special occasion. And he said that night, Mordecai Hamlin was preaching, and you can look this up, watch it, it's an awesome thing, but in Billy's own words, he looked at him and said, "Young man, you're a sinner." Now people, I'm not going to be that bold this morning, because I'm afraid it would be like this. Because I know as soon as I point at you, I can be pointing at me. But what he was saying was, this Mordecai Ham is kind of the model that Billy would follow his whole life. It was very direct about the truth. That he was right kind of in your face about it. And when he presented that truth, that young man, you are a sinner, and Billy Graham's heart was struck. And that night, he went forward at the end of that service and gave his life to Christ just before his 16th birthday. For 3 years, Billy says, he contemplated what that meant to his life in North Carolina, being raised on a farm, going to high school. In that wrestling period of time, he decided that that wasn't enough to just say, "I start with God." And in his words, it was a moonlit night. He went out seeking God's direction for his life. He said he knelt down, and in that moonlit night, he said to God, "I'm all in. You can have all of me and take me wherever you want me to go." And last Friday, we celebrated the life of this man, 99 years on this planet, who preached over 200 million people in 185 countries around the world. He was a 15-year-old dairy farmer. We, the Church of Jesus Christ today, have lost this idea that God doesn't care where you come from or how much you know. He just wants to know if you're available. And Billy Graham didn't know a whole lot. He was raised on a dairy farm. He wasn't highly educated. He wasn't top in his class, didn't get these marks. But God saw an available young man and called him at 16. And at 19, he committed his life fully to the Lord. And Billy Graham then pursued this following of God. He pursued it to Florida Bible Institute, followed by Wheaton College in Chicago, Illinois. At Wheaton, they say, is where Billy Graham got his preaching skills and his Bible study skills. At Wheaton, he was bounding down the steps one day when Ruth Bell saw him. Billy would later say he was in love, love at first sight, smitten with her, afraid to ask her out. She said, "You look like a young man in a hurry. Who wants to know a young man like that?" It made 63 years. Their first date was to take Billy, got the courage of it, asked her to go to the Messiah. That was their first date on Christmas. I texted my dad yesterday. I said, "I know something you and Billy Graham had to talk about." My father, at Moody Bible Institute, was singing the Messiah. It was the first date he had with my mother. So Billy Graham and my dad, pretty much the same guy. In that respect, you gotta finish the sentence, okay? So that marriage led its way into 5 children, but it was a tough, tough life for Ruth Bell Graham. Billy would be gone preaching 4, 5, 6, 7 months at a time. children you're raising. Most people say there was no Billy Graham without Ruth Graham. Most people know that the very first encourager, first accountability partner, the first person who believed in Billy, that held Billy to the standards that he wanted to be held to, was his wife, Ruth. She was born in China. 17 years in China as a missionary daughter. Most people believe that Billy's love for the world came from Ruth growing up in China, her love for the world. And together they made worldwide impact. YouTube is your best friend if you want to look this stuff up. There's some awesome pictures on YouTube of him preaching in Korea and South Africa and places around the world, 185 countries. Never afraid to go anywhere. Went to Russia during the Cold War. Went to South Africa and preached against apartheid, in the height of apartheid. Now, if you don't know that history lesson, young people, apartheid was the separation of white people from black people. And Billy said he would not go to South Africa until he was guaranteed to have a mixed audience, that anyone would be able to come to hear him preach. It was revolutionary. He spoke against the entire government of South Africa when he called apartheid a sin, and they grabbed hold of it and put it in the headlines of the paper in South Africa. He started out like some of us start out in preaching. He started out thinking that you have to have a certain number of messages, and you go out with those messages to preach them. So Billy says he made up 4 messages, 45 minutes in length, that he would be able to take anywhere and preach. So the first time he got on the pulpit, he preached all 4 of them in 8 minutes. I'm making it up, no words. That kind of a young preacher with a zeal for God and very little, you know, preparation, followed God into the world to proclaim the gospel. When he was asked about the title that he'd like to have, he said, preacher. If you see his tombstone, if you will, the stone on his grave that they put in, it says, preacher. All it says is Billy Graham, preacher of the Lord Jesus Christ. Doesn't have any other epitaph, no other words, it's preacher of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. So he went out preaching. You'll hear him like Larry King's interview with him. Larry King asks him about, you know, what you do and why you do it. He says, I believe I'm an evangelist. And he quotes the scripture that God calls some to be pastors and some to be evangelists. He says, I was called to be an evangelist, which means taking the good news of God, the gospel, to all the world. So that's what he did. But he started small. And the first ideas were he just preached in small churches and at revival meetings. And soon he got an invitation to go to Los Angeles and preach his first crusade. Now, he went to do his first crusade, kind of unknown, but before he did that, he saw the pitfalls and the traps to being someone like he would be, a public figure for God. So he recruited people around him. He recruited 2 people to be on his team, and those 2 people to be on his team are names that you would know if you followed him. He recruited George Beverly Shea to be his singer, and Cliff Barrows to be his leader of what they did in those meetings. So Cliff would put together the order of service and things like that. So when he called George Beverly Shea, he said, George, son, I'd like you to be my singer for some evangelistic campaigns I'm going to do. And this is George Beverly Shea's words. He said, so I said to Billy, the only people I've heard sing like that, sing a little, then they talk a little, do I have to talk? And Billy responded, I hope not. And they formed a bond around you sing, I do the talking. This is kind of like we do here. Mel does the singing, I do the talking. If this gets reversed, it could be one sad day. Because I'm a bad singer. I didn't mean Mel couldn't preach. They're taking that too far on that, okay? But from that, he also invited 2 of his high school friends, Grady and T.W. Wilson. They were kind of the business end of what they did in the Crusades. And a couple other guys, and they were in California before that first Crusade, and out of it came what they called the Modesto Manifesto. I love that. And what it was 4 commitments that they made that to the age of 99, when Billy passed away, these 4 things were true in his life and probably for how and why God could use him in the way that he did. These are the 4 things they meant accountability to. Financial accountability, moral integrity, respect for local churches and pastors, and truth and publicity. I heard stories that Billy Graham would not travel alone, that he always had his assistant with him. He would never stay in a motel room by himself because he never wanted to put himself into a situation that could go bad. That's just an amazing story and why everyone across all these lines these last 2 weeks has come to say great things about this guy, Larry King, all the news people. There was no lack of integrity ever in Billy Graham's dealings. So after that first invitation in Los Angeles, they went for about 2 weeks in Los Angeles. It didn't go very well. And this is how God worked. With those commitments and his team, God put this idea into a radio personality's head that you need to promote Billy Graham. As soon as he went on the radio and told people, come to his crusade, they began to grow. And then God did the phenomenal work that only God can do. And in that day, William Randolph Hearst was the biggest media mogul in the world. And he went public endorsing Billy Graham and his crusades. We have to think of this in terms of the only media, basically, that was print and radio. And he was the monster, the biggest promoter of and owner of all those media outlets. And he got Billy Graham going to the point where by the time they finished in L.A., about 2 million people had heard the message. And that was the start. So Billy Graham goes on his way, and he ends up, like I said to you early, preaching to 200 million people in 185 countries. That was just part of what he did. And then God widened his influence, and one of the ways he widened his influence is to worldwide leaders. A fascinating read for any of you who are involved in history in any way is grab the book called The Preacher and the Presidents. It is Billy Graham's relationship with all the presidents from Truman forward, and at the memorial service you saw all the way forward to our present president, Trump. All the way from Truman to Trump. I like that. I didn't figure that out until this time. Truman to Trump. Okay? But they all had a relationship with Billy Graham. And in that book, it tells you that that was not easy for Billy to do. Because every one of those presidents he met had their own, you know, faith place or lack of faith place. But he interacted with all of them. He got in trouble with Nixon. He was on tape, recorded on tape, of saying some things in a conversation with Nixon that he later was ashamed of. But like a man of integrity, Billy owned the statements that he made, said that he made them, didn't retract them, and said, I learned. I got too close to the power, and I need to be careful. But all the way to the present, when 9/11 happened, you remember, right, the tragedy of 9/11? Remember they shut down all the airports? If any of you were flying, you know how bad that was, right? One plane was allowed to fly. One plane was allowed to fly. The only plane allowed to fly carried Billy Graham to President Bush's office to consult and to talk to him about 9/11. And then he would bring about an 11-minute message in that service that they put together, a multi-phase service they put together that day. And you'll remember his words if you saw that. His amazing man stuff was also, and is recorded in many people's lives, that he was the same person. In fact, over and over, from several sources, I kept hearing these things where there was not two Billy Grahams. There was not two Billy Grahams. There was one Billy Graham. In other words, the person he saw preaching was the same person he saw at home and the same person in relationship to anyone. And he's such a man of integrity that he was the same person. He had his casket. It's not fascinating to read this story about his casket. Anybody know the casket story? His casket was made by prisoners. Men that he had influenced in his ministry who make caskets as part of their being in prison, and they made a plain casket with one condition, a cross. Because Billy Graham's life was about the cross. I'll show you a picture in just a minute about that. They made his casket. He began and did other things like Luzon conferences and schools of evangelism. I spent a week in Toronto, Canada when I was young in the ministry at Billy Graham School of Evangelism. Because when Billy Graham was asked who to replace him, Larry King asked him that, but many people did, and he would always say, and Franklin said this, I think, at the memorial service, he'd always say, at the training conferences, he would say, him and her and him and her, and he knew that what he was doing was raising up many people to do what he had done. Not just looking for one personality. There are great stories that came out about Billy's connection with other people. Kathy Lee Gifford said that she wanted to be an actress. And the place that she met Jesus was in a movie theater. Because Billy Graham had the courage, oh, this is a incredible thing, had the courage to put out movies before movies were something that Christians went to. Are you okay with that? In my household, you didn't go to movies. Good Baptist household. People don't go to movies in good Baptist households. My parents, I don't know, I can't just laugh at that. My parents probably didn't go to a movie until they were 70, let's say. And they started with Disney and State Fair. And they made it all the way, I think they might have gone to PG-13, but I'm not sure. They may still be on PG. What I'm telling you is, It was thought of that way in the Christian community, and Billy Graham saw a movie as a way to reach people in the world, and he put out this movie called The Restless Ones, and Kathy Lee Gifford went to that movie, gave her heart to the Lord. She said everyone in her family gave their heart to the Lord through the influence of Billy Graham. Frank Gifford and her parents, and everyone gave their life to Billy Graham. She became close friends with Billy. So she invited Billy to do something he'd never done before, which was to do a secular TV show. It was a Christmas special. She invited him to her house. He came to her house, and they were there, and they weren't quite ready for Billy to do his thing yet. And so Kathy Lee went to him and said, Billy, if I could get you anything, do anything for you, what would you want right now? I guess he got a little twinkle in his eye, she said, and he looked at her and said, I'd like a Big Mac. So Frank jumped in the car and went to McDonald's and got a bag full of Big Macs, and she says, and so Billy sat upstairs eating Big Macs before he went on TV. The real person, right? But listen, go on YouTube, watch her entire 7-minute story. Seriously great. She says this wonderful thing, though. He said that in their conversations, that he had a conversation with her about Bill Clinton's scandal when he was president. And this is what Billy Graham said about that. He said, I went to Mr. Clinton and said, I take sin seriously and I take redemption seriously. I take sin seriously and I take redemption seriously. Those are some powerful words, people, to a powerful person at the time. But Greg Lowry, who spent, say, the preacher who spent some time in the last two of Billy Graham crusades, said that he asked him, Billy, what would you tell a younger you? He said, I would tell a younger me, speak more on the cross and the blood of Christ, because that's where the power is. Now, what I would like to tell you is some of us, we're overcomplicating the message and bringing a lot of things in, and Billy never did. Every time you heard him, I don't think there's a time you heard him do a crusade where he didn't use John 3:16. Very simply, here's the gospel, here's the gospel, here's the gospel. Lee Strobel said there's four things you can learn. Lee Strobel is the author of The Case for Christ, the movie that's coming out. Four things you can learn from Billy Graham: integrity, humbleness, compassion, and always stand for God. This story was going through my head when we were doing worship this morning, because we started with victory in Jesus and old him, and then went into some contemporary things. This was Billy Graham's life. Michael W. Smith became a friend of Billy Graham's and was on crusades with Billy Graham. So at the time, this is in the 90s, Michael W. was bringing his music and, you know, Christian worship music, and it was a younger music. So in 1994, there was a crusade in Cleveland, and Billy Graham stepped out to do something that hadn't been done by his organization before. He created what they called Youth Night. And he invited Michael W. Smith and D.C. Talk to do the music instead of George Barrow Lucey and Cliff Barrows. And Michael W. Smith tells the story that there was great revolt from within the camp. Right? We've always done it that way.
Yeah.
Right? Not bad, but we've always done it that way. But Billy Graham, listen, Billy Graham had figured out that if the gospel was going to continue, that it had to get into the lives of young people, just like it had gotten into the lives of the parents that had come to hear him preach. He stepped out on the limb that night and he told him, Michael W. Smith's words, be rocked, he said. Now, you know, Michael W. Smith and rock and roll are still a little bit apart to me, okay? But they have stepped into something they've never done before. 85,000 people showed up that youth night. Michael W. says that the entire DC Talk band, himself, and Billy Graham's team stood off to the side and watched 10,000 kids walk the aisle. He said every one of them was bawling as they watched the kids come forward. That was what Billy Graham did. He knew that the gospel had to get in young people as much as it had to. He was 15 years old when God asked him to commit his life to him. 19 years old when he committed to going around the world in any place God would take him. I fear we just lose sight of that someday. We look into the front rows of the church and we go, hey, you guys are great. And when you grow up, you do something for God, I hope. And we miss the moment. 16 years old, 19 years old, God called this man to do about 80 years worth of ministry. Faithful to the end. 200 million people. Right before we watch something on a video on TV, that's TV on the screen, that's a picture of his life. I'm going to tell you the story that leads me into this. But one of the stories I ran across was the story of Bart Millar, who's the lead singer for Mercy Me. And you probably know Mercy Me through I Can Only Imagine, the song I Can Only Imagine. And there's a second that they put together through that song for Billy's life, but I want you to hear the personal side of this, not two Billy Grahams, or this one Billy Graham. So, Bart and his wife had just had Sam. He was a year old, and he developed type 1 diabetes. And so Sam, in his treatment for diabetes, his mom and dad were with him in the hospital. Well, at that time, Mercy Me was traveling with Billy Graham Crusade. So the people from the Crusade called Bart and said, hey, can you come? And Bart said, I can't. My son's just been diagnosed. I'm in the hospital. And they said, okay, we understand your priorities. They're right. No problem. No. Then he got a call back from them and said, hey, how about this? What if we get a private jet for you? We'll be flying you from Texas to Los Angeles. You do your thing. We'll fly you home the same night. And Bart said, okay. They said, oh, by the way, Billy Graham wants to pray for you that night. And Bart said, okay. So he got his guys together and he flew out the plane. He said, they're in the tent before the meeting, and it was a big deal. And he said, all of a sudden, there's a big ruckus on one side of the tent, and they see all of Billy Graham's people, all of his security people are on one side. Everyone gravitating there, like Billy has just showed up. And Bart says, I feel a hand on my shoulder, and I look, and it's Billy Graham. And he says, sometimes you have to create a ruckus to get a moment by yourself. And he says, I want to pray for Sam. And he says, this is my picture of Billy Graham. Put his arm around me. Pray for my son, my name, with tears in his eyes. The same man who preached to 200 million people in his lifetime knew this one-year-old boy's name and prayed for him with tears in his eyes. And that man, God used. And this isn't an attempt by me to tell you how great this man was this morning. I was incredibly inspired as I watched the memorial service and went through these videos and read more about his life. I was personally inspired to say, am I okay with being a person like this? Are we okay with being a church full of people who understand that the power is in the cross and in the shed blood of Jesus Christ? And that we are told to be bold about our message and to go into the world? It just so happened that I've been preparing a message today out of the book of Acts when all this kind of came to my forefront, and I put them together for you, and I just want to use one verse today to show you how God orchestrated this for me. In Acts chapter 1, the second verse, the disciples are now waiting for the coming of the Holy Spirit. Jesus has been crucified, he's been resurrected, he's met with his guys, and he's told them, wait it out until the Spirit comes on you, and then you're going to launch the gospel into the world. And then the second verse of Acts chapter 1, the phrase is used in the NIV, and it goes like this, given orders to the apostles. That he had given orders to the apostles. The word charge or command or instructions could also be used there. They are in different versions. But listen, in the second verse, it just kind of puts the whole world right for you and I. That we are given orders by God. And right in my Bible, on the side, in the reference verses, there were three verses, because I started saying, well, what are those orders? Right? You know, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And second command is just like that. Love your neighbor as yourself. Is that the order? Is that the marching order? Surely that's what you build your life around, right? Loving people, loving God, right? But actually, specifically, the orders that the apostles were given were these orders, Matthew 28:19, go, make disciples of the nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Mark 16:15, go into all the world, preach to all creation. John 20:21, right when he meets with them the first time after the crucifixion, the rather peace to you, he says, I give you my peace. As the Father has sent me, so send I you. Out of the world, so send I you. Billy Graham would look at crowds of people, he wasn't trying to replace himself. He, in his heart, I'm sure, knew, listen, the harvest is plentiful. It's the harvest we're looking for. And I put those two thoughts together and I said, yeah, we want to be a church that understands that we have been given marching orders by God himself. Marching orders to spread the gospel. I don't care if you're doing someone's hair. You might have the opportunity to spread the gospel to them because people sit in a chair in a beauty salon just like they do in a barbershop. And sometimes they open their heart to the people helping them. And in the classroom, as a teacher walks alongside of a student, and the student brings the world that they live in into that classroom, it's a heartbreaking world. And a world that's not a loving and kind atmosphere. And sometimes the teacher brings God right to the student in that way. And sometimes in your office, someone stops by and they say, can I talk to you? And they pour out life. And this is how you and I are taking the gospel into the world. Billy, how would you tell a younger yourself? I tell tell myself, preach more on the cross and the blood because that's where the power is. And we're X number of Easter weeks, where we have an awesome setup with people to bring them to church. And that's what we're talking about that day. We should talk about every day is the power of the cross. Because nobody died for sins like Jesus Christ did. And that message is a worldwide message. Billy, in one of his statements, said, in fact, it was in South Africa, he said to the people, he said, don't let anyone tell you that God is the God of white people. He said, God is the God of the whole world. What a message, people. What a message in a context that we live in where there's so much strife and so much of this racial stuff. And this God, this one guy from North Carolina who is a dairy farmer's son, has stood up in front of millions of people telling them he's the God of the whole world. Because he said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Mercy Me put this together with a song, I Can Only Imagine. It's 5 minutes long. I just want you to see this powerful man's life. And I want you to understand that from Franklin and the rest of his family members, that all the family members said the one thing about their father was that he would never accept credit for what God was doing. That his humility was genuine. And that somewhat what they did in that memorial service for him was everyone that spoke as a family person pointed back to the cross, pointed back to the gospel. So here's a little tribute, not about Mr. Graham, but about the fact that he had preaching the simple gospel.
The moment you read in the paper that Billy Graham is dead, you'll know that he's more alive than he's ever been before, and I'm in paradise. And I'm looking forward to it.
Marking day for the gospel, for the good news, for Jesus is unprecedented. What a life well lived.
Well, he was one of the most important Christian evangelists you ever heard.
Yes. I'm going to ask you to make a commitment tonight to be sure that you know Christ and that you're ready for eternity.
So we're going to go to this communion table, and how this is going to work is I'm going to have Brandon and Al, and can I get Michael and Chuck to help me, maybe members of my leadership team, and so there'll be four of me, maybe Michael on this side, and Al, Brandon in the middle, and maybe Chuck, you can take this side, and so they'll have the elements of the communion with them. So how we're going to do this is we're going to sing this song as you come. Maybe sing it by word or whatever, maybe we'll sing it a couple of times through, but I want to remind you what we're doing this morning is when Billy talked about the cross, these elements are that means of grace that the cross represents. They represent the body of Christ given for us and the shed blood of Christ. The Bible says without that, there's no forgiveness of sins. Coming to this table is a means of grace where God fills you again with his power, but you must have a relationship with. So I encourage all of you today as you come to understand this is about our relationship, personal relationship with God. Not about religion. Kathy Lee in her interview, and she's talking about Billy Graham, said, one thing I love about him is he never talked about religion, he always talked about relationship. So if you have a relationship with God this morning, this table is open for you. It's your means of grace. If you haven't met Jesus, but this morning God has been tapping on your heart, is simply right where you are before you come forward to communion and say, God, I give you my heart. I confess my sins and invite you to be my Lord and Savior. And then we celebrate together. So, we're going to sing this song. I'm going to pray first. We'll sing this song. You come, take the elements back to your chair. Maybe spend a moment of contemplation. Everyone has been served. Then we'll take the elements together. God, bless these elements today, not just as bread and juice, but as this wonderful idea of the cross, of the shed blood and the body given for us, taking our sins on that cross so that we might know forgiveness, and that empty tomb representing that death couldn't hold you back, and that even that day you conquered death by your resurrection. Our hope, Lord, is in you. We praise you for these moments. Now as we take, God, we take into our heart, not just into our body. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Okay, go ahead and stop.
do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it. Thank you.